That was a clip from the Netflix series The Get Down. From choir robes to risque clothes, do women have to bear all to be successful in the music industry? So I like what I see when I'm looking at me when I'm walking past the mirror. Don't stress through the night at a time in my life. Ain't worried about if you feel it. Got my head on straight, I got my vibe right. I ain't gonna let you kill it. See, I won't change my life just fine. Hello and welcome to A Seat at the Table. I'm Christine White. According to Forbes, the music industry still has a long way to go to achieve gender equality.
I'm Deneen Milner. Women are held to double standards in almost every industry, but in the entertainment business, the perception of women is a bit more harsh. They're stereotyped, sexualized, and marginalized for not being men.
And I'm Monica Pearson. Today, we're taking a deeper look into the pros and cons of the music industry and how Black women navigate their way to success.
This topic is really interesting to me because I spent a lot of time as an entertainment reporter, right? Mm. And I got to see from the business perspective or from an entertainment reporting perspective as a journalist, how people treated men versus the way that they treated women. When it came to paying them, it was different. When it came to how they talked to them, it was different. When it came to the kind of representation that they gave them, it was, you know, just completely different. And I kind of felt like you have such a short shelf life in the entertainment business, right? Mm-hmm. Like, very few people go on to have the kind of soaring careers that, say, like a Celine Dion has or Whitney Houston had, right?
It's scary. I mean, as a young person, I thought that the music industry was the one place we could finally be ourselves. Hmm. It was the one place where Black culture was finally, like, loved and appreciated. And then you get in and you realize, like, it's not for women at all. Like, they are literally just to be a representation, but not about the whole person.
And a representation created by men.
Right.
Now, as an entertainment lawyer, you've seen it on the business side.
It's a little scary. I mean, I never represented any women. Everyone I worked with were men. And so the saddest thing for me was me having to prove myself all the time. Hmm. So it was really personal for me having to prove that I wasn't there to get close to anybody, that I wasn't there to serve anybody sexually. Like,
The automatic assumption was that, oh, she cute, she can be tried.
Right.
Easily.
And the assumption was the only reason you would work in the music industry is because you were trying to be some sexual tool for men. Right. And that was just not my experience. I love the culture. Mm-hmm. And it's so sad that when you go looking for that sort of validation in a culture that was created for you by you, that you are told that you're not really supposed to be there because you're a woman.
Now, I'm going to give you another perspective, and that is, and this comes from a white female, someone like Trisha Yearwood, who was a singer and had been a singer all her life. But what she did, she went to school and got a degree in the business, for lack of a better phrase, so that she knew how to negotiate a contract. She knew how to protect her publishing rights. Right. And I think what often happens is that we get pulled into it because someone sees you at a talent show or you send in a demo, and then they're calling you. Mm-hmm. And the next thing you know, someone has taken over your life. Right. And because they have the experience, your parents go, well, they know more than we do about the business. Right. Or they go, well, maybe that's what you're supposed to do. And what happens with young women, because as we see in the music videos, they're all shaking their booties, boobs hanging out, and their tools, mm-hmm. versus women who really know how to sing and feel that they have to compromise themselves in some way just to get a foot in the door.
Well, the music industry, I believe, really was based on manipulation and exploitation. So the way that the publishing laws are written, it's overly complicated for reasons that aren't necessary, right? And so they keep that piece hidden and they keep it shrouded from entertainers and even novice managers mm-hmm. so that they don't ever really understand the value of their talent. And so in a situation that's primarily male dominated, where the expectation is that women are there to be used anyway, then they become even greater targets.
Right.
And that is, it's cultural, but it is also sort of baked into the business.
And greed.
Right? Yeah, and greed.
Like, I just never in my life could really understand there's so much money to be made mm-hmm. in the entertainment industry.
I mean, I think that really what has happened is that women have gone into the music industry without the expectation that they would be in control. That there is an expectation, sometimes even as artists, that that's not my job.
When you go into the entertainment business, you have to put the emphasis now on the business.
Yes, right. Absolutely.
And in
right.
the past, we have not done that.
Absolutely.
And we as women have been afraid to flex
Absolutely.
Because we think,
Absolutely.
Well, if I do, they're not going to accept it. Look at the transition that TLC made.
Right.
Even though they started out dressing like what I call basically covered up,
mm-hmm.
they soon switched over to right. more sexualized clothing right. because someone was telling them, this is what the audience
okay,
wants.
Okay, 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 you guys, we got to stop.
Okay.
Before we get any deeper into this subject, let's take a look at a clip from between Nicki Minaj and Queen Latifah.
Okay. Like, I'm on the bottom of every totem pole, I feel like, really, because in terms of proving yourself, in terms of showing that you're intelligent and you can carry on a conversation and
right.
you can speak about, you know, many different topics. So I felt like I was kind of representing for so many different people, like rap and then black women and then women in general, being on Idol.
I think we all can resemble that remark. Now we're joined by Ursula Yancy. She's also known as Urs Verse. She is a three-time Grammy-nominated singer-songwriter. Ursula has written for Rihanna, J-Lo, Tamar Braxton, and that's just to name a few, and recently released her debut album, Mistaken Fantasy. So, Ursula, what were your thoughts when you heard what Nicki Minaj said?
I agree with her. You know, as a black woman in the music industry, it's kind of hard because it's not too many women that are in the industry that are that make it mainstream. So,
Now you are a writer,
yes.
and a producer,
yes.
and now you're a performer.
Yes.
How hard was it for you to break in as a writer, and what did you have to do to get the attention?
Oh my God, it was really hard, actually. You know, I had to like work twice as hard as the men did, you know, and I had to, you know, basically put up with a lot of shenanigans.
Mm-hmm. Well, only 12% of the songwriters in pop culture are women. Only 2% are producers.
Wow.
Why do you think that is such a huge barrier? I mean, 2%, that's really small.
Right. You have to have thick skin to be in this industry. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to have thick skin as a woman in any industry, and then mm-hmm. especially as a black woman. You have to think about time. How much time are you gonna put in? A lot of females, they don't want to put in that time. Mm-hmm. A lot of females have families as well.
Mm-hmm.
So there's different factors mm-hmm. that
right.
apply.
But, you know, I get back to your songwriting, because that's where you make your money,
right.
to be very honest.
Right.
Your publishing rights.
Yeah.
But how do you get someone to take your music? How did you get to a Rihanna? How did you get to a J-Lo? Did it have to go through a man?
Ooh, let me see. Did it? Everything has to go through a man in this industry, so
right.
pretty much, yeah. But I did... My first placement was actually on Christina DeBarge, and it did go through a man, two men, L.A. Reid and Babyface. So, yeah.
How did you transition into being a singer? And I can only imagine that there's a big difference between mm-hmm. being behind the scenes mm. and then being in front of it. And did you learn how to basically stand up in front of people and sing based off of
Or better yet, how did you convince them
right,
that you could do it, since they saw you as only a songwriter and a producer?
Right.
Yeah, they will put you in a box if you let them, but you gotta... I didn't let them put me in a box.
Mm.
I started off songwriting, and I demo every song that I write for the artists already, male and female. So when I do the songs for the different artists, I'm already singing the song.
Mm-hmm.
I'm already singing the backgrounds. I'm already singing the leads, and I write the songs out. So I was already used to recording, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But being an artist is totally different from, you know, songwriting.
In what way? What is it that you're finding as a woman artist?
It's harder. It's harder as a female artist than a songwriter. I thought it was hard as a songwriter, mm-hmm. you know, but now you have to get them to take you seriously. You have to, they're like, oh, you got to dress this way and, you know, you got to show a little this and do that, or everybody's doing a twerking challenge. Do the twerk challenge. See, it's a lot going on.
That and, bothers me, yeah. though, because I don't think that men are the only ones who have a perspective, are the only ones who can tell who's talented. And from what I'm hearing, everything has to be green-lighted through a man. What would the music industry be if it was all women decision-makers?
Come on now.
I mean, what would the distribution, if we didn't have to go through a man for distribution and for the radio production and for the videos, like if women made all those decisions, do you think that music would be different?
I think it would be different.
Yeah.
Yeah. And actually, that's what I started to do. So I said, you know what? I'm going to do it on my own. Mm-hmm. So as an artist, I basically write my own songs. I pick my own tracks. Mm-hmm. I actually put the whole album together. Mm-hmm. I designed my own web, the image, the image. And right. What I did was, the music industry has changed. Mm-hmm. So people aren't buying CDs anymore.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Hold it up, please.
Which makes it hard for an independent artist, you know, trying to sell CDs. Right. So, you know, and then they've eliminated CD players from your cars, from your computers, from everything.
That's right.
So I said, what can I do different that could help, like, independent artists like myself? Mm-hmm. So what I did was I put the album on a USB drive.
Smart.
And then I came with the CD booklets, like back in the day, with the lyric
booklets. I miss the artwork. And that used to be our jam. Yeah. Like, we used to wait.
That's
to open
how
it
I learned how to be a writer. Yes. Looking at the lyrics inside of albums and really just sort of having that engagement, being able to touch it and to see it
but
and actually hear it.
But you did that on your own.
Absolutely.
Now, why couldn't you do it through your label?
Well, because if I was signed to a major label, then you would have to go through too many channels.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Too many channels, too many men, too many yes and no's, and it's too much. And sometimes people don't see your vision, you know?
What about sustainability? Like, what does it take to remain in this industry? You're already bumping up against walls, sexism, colorism, already having people, you know, make sure that you get the smallest piece of the pie. You're like, here's a little bite, and that's all you're getting.
For your creativity.
How do you maintain yourself in an industry and sustain yourself later on down the line?
Well, you gotta learn about the pie.
Right.
You gotta
right.
learn what That's pie right. is, mm-hmm. you know? So a part of the pie is not just being an artist. Right. It's knowing what the publishing is. It's about doing your split sheets. Mm-hmm. It's about doing your paperwork and doing everything the right way.
Mm-hmm. What do you think that women who aspire to be songwriters, what advice would you give them?
Ooh, I would tell them, A, learn about publishing.
Yes.
That's first and foremost. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't know about publishing, I don't know if songwriting's a thing for you, you know?
Right.
Don't put all your eggs in one basket, you know? A lot of these artists, they're like, they're trying to chase after one major artist. Like, they're like, oh, if I could just get a song on Rihanna or J-Lo or Usher or anybody big, that they'll make it and blow up. But sometimes focus on the artists that are coming up with the talent that nobody else wants to work with.
Right.
And that's what I really did, honestly. I'm not saying that nobody wants to work with any of the artists that I work with. Right. I'm just saying, like, when I first started out writing music, I didn't discriminate, and then I always gave my best to everybody. So a song that I would do for a Rihanna or a J-Lo or a Tamar or a Music Soul Child, I would still do for the new artist coming up.
We've got to take a quick break, but stay with us. When we come back, we'll be joined by a music and entertainment professional that is responsible for her son's career and superstardom. I take a picture of your Facebook.
Forget all of the record sales, forget all of trying to compete or trying to outdo yourself. You should be doing it just because you love it. And that's what I always want to have. I never want to lose that.
Welcome back to A Seat at the Table. Joining us now is Jonnetta Patton, founder of Jay's Kitchen Culinary Incubator. Jonnetta is highly regarded as an entertainment professional with 17 years of experience. She managed her sons, Usher and Jaylak, both Grammy Award winners. Jonnetta and Ursula, we are so excited to have both of you here. But Jonnetta, I've got to start with you. Just talk about some of the obstacles that were thrown in your path when you realized at 14 you had a son who could sing.
Well, first of all, I would like to say that all of this actually starts with you. Mm. You have to actually love yourself first.
Yeah. Mm.
Before you enter this business or any business, you have to love yourself first. Mm. It's about purpose. It's about passion, integrity, and focus. And I'm here today because when I, you know, did my research, I thought, wow, so amazing. Mm-hmm. And you've worked with the top professionals.
You know, I remember when Usher first hit the scene. I'm a little bit older than him. Mm-hmm. And what I remember always was that his mother was the one who was behind him.
Yes.
Making sure that he was protected in the industry. Mm-hmm. What did it take for you to get the respect that you demanded to be able to do your job? Because we all have sort of these crazy ideas of what a mominger is,
right,
and how difficult they can be.
First, I did not allow you to call me a mominger. Mm-hmm. I am a manager, mm-hmm, just like
that's right,
other
right,
that's right,
men, they're mm-hmm managers.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Second, I know my true potential, so you can't tell me what I can and cannot do.
Mm-hmm. Right.
My purpose is to make my son the biggest artist in the world with integrity.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You have to also study. Yeah. Women, you have to study your industry. Mm-hmm. I knew what I was talking about.
Right.
So when I walk into a boardroom, I know what I'm talking about.
Right.
Because so music, you have to respect that.
Yeah, the music industry is different than general business. There are things that are a little bit different than if you're working in corporate America or if you're working in real estate. How did you learn that stuff as you were sort of moving through, as you were, the stuff that you can't get out of a book?
Well, I think all industries have that.
Yeah.
And it is through trial and error.
Yeah.
You know, then that's how I learned it. And connecting with the right people.
That's right.
You have to connect with the right people because everyone that gets in your face, they're not good for you.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But you have a backbone that a lot of people don't have. And I remember when you opened your studio, mm-hmm, you've got to tell the story because you were really being set up to fail.
I really mm-hmm was. And that's what I'm talking about.
Oh, wow.
You know, I truly know my true ability. Right. They just didn't.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another thing, too. You know, as a woman, you can never feel let them know that you're intimidated. And you might be, but you don't let them know that.
Wow.
So with me, because I was a mother, which I feel myself, they didn't know this, everyone respects their mother and mm-hmm loves their mother.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, I'm a mother. I'm intelligent. I know my industry. So when I step into a boardroom, you're not talking to a mother. You're talking to a real professional.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you have to respect that professional. Usher was losing his voice at the age of 14, puberty.
Mm.
So in this industry, it's money driven. How much money can you make from me?
Right.
We had to do a showcase for the administrative staff. And I was like, okay, we can do it. He has lost his voice, but we're gonna work through this. Everyone sat down on him because he lost his voice. Mm. We were getting ready for the showcase, and I kept calling. Okay, where's my dad, which was, you
right
know, the music.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And we're bringing it. Okay, where are we rehearsing?
Right.
Okay, we're gonna send you that information, and I'm waiting on it, time is running out, but little did they know, we had already been working with a band.
Right.
Right.
So whether you give it to me or not,
listen,
I'm
ready.
I'm so
you know, ahead of the game because I know if you're, what you're doing, you're setting me up for failure.
Right.
You want him to think your mother's not competent. I mean, she cannot do this. You need to, we need to give you a real manager.
Right.
Your mother cannot do this. So the day of the showcase, I haven't received any music.
Listen.
I don't have a location to rehearse. And I was like, you know what, God, get me through this. And I will have my own place. You will be paying me.
Yes. Yes.
You will be paying me to rehearse in my studio.
So you went and bought your own studio.
Yes, ma'am. I went and bought my own studio.
Nobody loves you more than your mama.
Honey.
And if that person can't take care of you.
This business doesn't care.
Right. Mm-hmm.
They don't care. And that's why going into this business, you have to love you. There's a lot of give and take. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of give and take. Well, I had that connection, you know, with my son. Because I properly raised him.
Mm-hmm. Was there ever a time where you felt like, we just gonna walk away? Like,
There has been times, that I just wished it had never happened.
Wow.
There were times it got that tough.
Wow.
Until it's like, you know what? I don't need this.
Right.
But because it was his passion.
Right.
It was his passion. That I stayed with it.
Right.
Ursula, have you ever been like that?
Listen, I wanted to quit, like, recently.
So many times.
I mean, before I did this, like, literally, I wasn't even going to come out with an album. I was like, you know what? I'm done with the industry. I'm tired of this. I don't, you know, it's a lot of shenanigans. You know.
Ma'am.
It's a lot of shenanigans. Right. And it's all types of different things. And the crazy part about it, it's not just men, though. It's women too, because it's not a lot of women in this industry. So the women that are in it, they're trying to fight to keep their position instead of saying like, you know what, you're a woman, let's all work together, you know?
Yeah. But see, that's where you have to know your own potential.
Absolutely.
And you have to stay focused.
That's right.
On the purpose.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I have turned things down that people say, what? You turned that down? Yeah, sure did. Yeah. Right. It did not fit.
Right.
Yeah. I'm very strategic.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Just because you want to do it, and that's why I'm labeled.
Right.
I'm labeled as a difficult person, mm-hmm. and I'm not. Mm-hmm.
But if you were a man, do you think that you would be labeled as
difficult?
No,
absolutely
not at all.
And that's what I'm talking
about. You'd be
about.
A strategic
yes.
businesswoman.
Yes. A genius.
But let me tell you this. I can't tell you this, because it's not all bad. Mm-hmm. You have those that are strategic as well, and they're business-minded people. They respect what I do.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
So those are the people that I really pay attention to.
Yeah.
From the music industry, I reinvented myself from music to culinary. The transition has been amazing. And you know why? It's because of the work. When we started in the very beginning and we were making all this money, we owed $40,000 to Internal Revenue. Mm. So I went to the record company, because I'm bold like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, we need $40,000.
Right.
Well, they said, we'll give you $40,000, but you have to give us all of your publishing.
Oh, No.
What?
Lord.
I said, no, you will not get $40,000. You will not get all of my publishing for $40,000.
Thank you. The audacity.
Yeah.
But that happens.
Yeah, every
day.
That
happens. And if you don't know who you are as an artist, mm-hmm. you're yield to that.
Yeah.
Right.
I went to EMI. Mm-hmm. Big John was over there.
Right.
And I said, Big John, I know Usher's not proven. I know that. But I'm telling you,
mm-hmm.
he's going to be big.
Mm-hmm.
I need $40,000. So let's talk about a publishing deal, because I'm proven.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I'm proven, and he believes in me,
right.
and he believes in my son. He didn't give us $40,000. We did $1 million deal.
Wow.
That was the
as a new artist.
As a new artist.
That's amazing.
Unproven.
Wow.
That's amazing. $1 million deal. And he still has his publishing.
Mm. Right.
Yeah.
He still makes money. He still received royalty checks.
Right.
That's good.
He didn't take it all.
Yeah.
Right.
That's greed, which you talked about,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
Greed.
Well,
absolutely.
You know, we could sit here all day and talk about this, but the lesson think you have shared with us, both of you, is a simple one. To thine own self be true.
Well, let me just leave you with this note. Your team is very important.
Yes.
Take your time and find the right executives.
Your conversation destined. Doesn't have to end here, but we gotta go. So join us. I'm
sorry.
Sorry. I could talk about this all day.
All day, right.
I could go on and on and on.
Same here. Same here. Share your thoughts with us on social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Pinterest, and now YouTube at ASATTTV.
And thanks for joining us for A Seat at the Table. And in the words of Shirley Chisholm, if they don't give you a seat at the table,
bring a folding chair.
Listen.
All these rules and regulations, making it way too complicated, way too